Pauliners, would you join me in singing?
I heard
Lord of all. bless you and to honor the Lord and to remember Ms. Rogers. And that's fitting that we should do all of that. We get together for ceremonies like this and various things take place. You know, families, it's funny. If your family's like my family, we always say we need to get together more often, but we show up for times like this. But at the same time, you probably did more talking, more interacting, sharing more stories and memories and passing things on to the next generation that they wouldn't know if we didn't do things like this. But above all, there's a presence here today that is so important, and it's the presence of the Lord through the Holy Spirit, who is called the Comforter. And so we want to pray, and then we're going to honor the Lord, and we're going to do some remembering and reminiscing, and then we're going to hear from the Word of God. And when we get through with all of this, our prayer is that you're blessed and that Christ is honored. So let's pray together, okay? Father, I know what it's like to be in this family situation. Most of us do. We've lost people, we've lost friends, loved ones, parents, children in some cases. And one of the things that we know is it hurts. And there's nothing we can do that makes the hurt go away. It's supposed to hurt because we were close and because we loved. And wherever there's love, there's a hole. But we also want to thank you that we're not just wandering around in the dark, stumbling around, trying anything we can. We can go to the light of the Word of God, and we can see Jesus, the Messiah we just sang about, and we can find comfort, hope, and peace in Him. So thank you, Father, for families. Thank you for the lives of people you put into our life. And thank you for the way they enrich us and teach us and train us. They set an example for us. And thank you, Lord, that we have the opportunity to carry on what they have taught us. May that be done today for the glory of God and the comfort of this family. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Thank you, Dale. I'm getting to do something this morning that I've wanted to do, and God has put it up on my heart to do for many years. I got to sing with Dale Marshall and Greg Kenyon on the same platform. So I'm thankful for that. I've always admired their singing. I cannot sing. I can make a noise, but not sing. And I appreciate the fact that Risa indicated to us early on that this would be a celebration service. So we're not talking about leaving home. We're talking about going home. For the child of God, he's on his way home. We're just passing through here. And the longer I stay here, the less I like it, to be truthful. And I think the less it likes me. So this morning, I want to take the time before I read the obituary. And by the way, the obituaries don't tell you a whole lot, do they? From the day she was born to the day God took her, we don't read a whole lot about that. But those were the days, that's her life. That was her life. And I've always seen, my family's had the privilege of being near her family and around her children, around her, Joe, and early on, her first husband, Wilburn. Sweet man, I remember him being such a sweet fella. But what I saw and what I remember seeing is a mutual admiration society in a family. I see that even today. I can remember, Randy, when your mom would think, well, now Randy's coming to Oklahoma City to spend a time or two, she'd get excited and thrilled, looking forward to that. And I want to commend you kids. Not only did she knew that you were very capable, she knew that, and she was proud of that. She didn't boast upon it, but she knew her children knew what to do and how to do it. And a lot of that came from the input from her, and of course her husband. But you kids have been to her what she needed to be also, what you need to be to her. There are needs that people think, well, when you get old, you don't need any needs. You need all the needs when you get older. And you need that input from people that love you. You go a long way, dear people, when you know that people love you. That paves the road to a lot of good feelings. And you have done that, Randy. Every time I think of the needs of your mom, you've taken care of them. Russ and Risa, you do the same thing. I think also Renee didn't have the capabilities and possibilities that the others had, but she needed her. When they were together, they were just like sisters. And so I got to see those precious things in the life of a family. Those are the things God's people ought to see in every family, and a continuation of that. Let me just read you the obituary, then I want to make a comment if I could. And I know this is a celebration, and so knowing Pauline and knowing how she loved life, when we go to her house or dinner or something, there's always a joy, always an anticipated joy of knowing she's a good cook to begin with, but she just liked to cook and talk, and then talk some more. And she just loved life. Now I want to relay something to you that, if you'll allow me to share with you my imagination, sanctified imagination, by the way, I'm going to tell you something about her. Pauline passed from this earth this past month. She was born in Chattanooga, Oklahoma, to Claude and Nora Taylor. Her childhood, she was born during the Depression, so she had a tough childhood. Things weren't easy for her. They learned to enjoy the things, to become fond memories of her childhood. She comes from a large musical family. They invented a lot of things to do, as people did in those days. Hobbies including horse riding, playing sports, roller skating. She began to work as a young teenager at a local soda fountain, and then in the Coca-Cola bottling company in Lawton, Oklahoma. Age 18, she met her late husband, was married February the 24th, 1950, in Purcell, Oklahoma. In the summer of 1954, Randy was born, and then a daughter came 20 months later, Renee. The last of the three children, Risa, was born in 1960, and their family was complete. And during the fall of 1979, Pauline was invited to church where she came to know the Lord and started her walk with the Lord. That's the obituary, her walk with the Lord. Pauline was 49 when Wilburn passed away. And she soon found the most loving man, Joseph. And I have to attest to that as well. I've never met a guy that never heard him complain about anything. Just compliments of people, love people. Folks, the reason you can do that is because you love the Lord. It's the only way you can do that. So thank you, Joe, for being what she needed to be for her for 39 years. And I know she'll be dearly missed of you. I have no idea what that would be like. But I know that God will take care of the needs, whatever there are in your life. And he'll use your children, he'll use people you know to do that. Pauline owned a business, sewing business, custom drapery and bedding. Her hobbies included traveling, reading, socializing. Pauline's passion for life was her walk with the Lord, with her husband, her children, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren. She could never pass up the ambition of holding a child, just holding a child. I always thought that's so neat, see somebody, children read you, dear people. People, kids that are 2 and 3 know what you're thinking. How many of them come up and grab your leg and hang on to it? Those that do trust you. Many don't, because they know they can't. You can't be trusted. You really don't love people like they love, like they need to be loved. She never passed up a chance to hold a child. Always the first one to be called, one to babysit. We remember her for her sharp, funny wit. She'd say things that I'd never heard my grandmother say, you know? Just things that are just off the cuff, that just deep truths and deep things that you could really laugh at. Had a positive outlook on life, most of her love and selfless heart for her husband, her grandchildren, and her great-grandchildren. And I'll save the rest of that for you to read, her people that she has survived, preceded her in death, children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. But let me just share this with you before the message this morning. Again, let me ask you to allow me to allow I look at it and I think, well, it's kind of the divine ambition that I have. It's something that I think people do that I don't hear them do, but I think they would do. And so I heard a friend say this, and I thought Pauline when I heard it. He said, he was asked, what do you want people to say about you when you're gone? What do you want people to say about you when they see you in the casket and they pass by? And of course, the natural reaction would be, well, I want them to think well of me. I want them to remember me as a friend. I want them to remember me as somebody who's kind, considerate. I want them to remember me when they remember good things. But deep down in my heart, deep down in my thinking, I'm thinking if you were asked Pauline that, she'd think real deep and long and say, finally, I think she would like to hear this said about her. Look, she's moving. I think that's her personality. And I thank God that I had a chance, the opportunity to know her.
Hi, my name is Brooke Mowdy, and I am one of Pauline's granddaughters. She was Mimi to my sister and I, and I would like to say a few words to brag on her, as she always did so much of her family to anyone with an earshot. I think we can all agree that Mimi was truly one of a kind. Her love, sense of humor, and bold and social and friendly personality set her apart. From as far back as I can remember, Mimi was always there supporting her grandchildren, whether it be in the school play, sporting events, or attendance to every birthday party. I could always count on her to call me on my birthday, and as soon as I would say hello, she would sing the entire happy birthday song before I could even utter another word. For my 10th birthday, she wanted to take me to get my fingernails done with the real acrylic fake nails. We drove across town to New York Nails because they were the best, according to her, and I was going to get the royal treatment for my birthday. We left with matching manicures, and I felt like a true princess. She had the fiercest love for her family and always wanted the best for each member. Anytime my friends were around her, they would say, "I just love your grandma. She's so sweet and makes me feel so comfortable." I would visit her at her assisted living center where she lived. She would parade me around the dining room and introduce me to all of her friends, all of whom already knew me and my entire life story, from Mimi's stories each day at dinner. She was warm, positive, and such a giver. All these traits to which her three children were blessed to inherit from her. A friend of my mother's once said, "I think Pauline's kids are so successful because she has always been so encouraging and has always lifted her children up, believing there was nothing they couldn't do. That's the kind of mother I strive to be." She was an amazing cook and seamstress, where she used her talents to bless others, providing a warm home-cooked meal or making someone a personalized blanket or dress were her specialties. She gave of her time, money, and talent. She especially loved her husband, my Poppy, to which she was a great example of a devoted wife. She told me when I was a child that they fell asleep each night holding hands. The only thing in this life you can take with you to heaven are relationships, and my Mimi was the richest woman on the planet in relationships. She was a people person and never found an awkward conversation. In 2018, I found out that I was expecting triplets. She was beyond excited and began brainstorming all the items she could sew them. She insisted that we all call the local news stations, and she just knew they would want to follow me around with their cameras and be the latest and greatest news story. I said, "Mimi, I'm not the only person that's had three babies before," but she didn't care. She wanted to show them off to the world. And after they were born, I brought them to her assisted living center, where she showed them off to each of her friends, announcing that they were her babies. She absolutely loved her great-grandbabies and would rock them and sing to them as long as they would let her. As far back as I can remember, Mimi would always sing a song to me, and later would sing the same song to my babies as she rocked them. I'd like to read the lyrics to the song now. It's called "What a Day That Will Be." "There is coming a day where no heartaches shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. There will be no sorrows there and no more burdens to bear. No more sickness and no more pain. No more parting over there. And forever will I be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be." Though we grieve her presence and special quirks here on earth, I'm elated for her that she got to experience the words of that song on Thursday night. Now I'd like to thank you all for coming today. Pauline would love and appreciate that, being such a social girl as she was. She would be so happy to see us all gathered together, comforting one another and remembering her. From the bottom of my heart, thank you.
Sadness has found me. I'd do anything for more time. Never before has someone meant more, and I can't get you out of my mind. There is so much that I don't understand, but I know. I'm family, love for all people, love for the Father and Son. Your heart will be heard in your unspoken words through generations to come. There's so much that I don't understand, but I know.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Will I sing hallelujah? Will I is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. This world is not what it was meant to be. All this pain, all this suffering. There's a better place waiting for me in heaven. Every tear will be wiped away. Every sorrow and sin erased. We'll dance on seas of amazing grace. In heaven, in heaven, I'm going home where the streets are golden, every chain is broken. Oh, I wanna go. Oh, I wanna go home where every fear is gone. I'm
Great lady, huh? Great life. And it's, well, Risa, when you asked me the other day to do this, I hung up the phone. I go, there's no way if anything's under my control that I'm not going to do this. And so we'll get through it. And thank you for the privilege of doing this and being a part of it. Brother Don, it's good to be with you. And your singing is better than your joke. Look, she's moving. My goodness. And Brooke, you did such a good job. And Risa, for you and your brother and your sister, I can identify with where you are right now. Joe, I can't really identify with you, and my heart goes out to you, and I pray for you, because these are kind of hard times. And as we know, this is all a part of life. We're born, and we have a certain number of days that God has given us, and we live in the strength of the Lord and for the glory of the Lord. And he brings things into our life that we never anticipated. The pathway we go down, we never could really plan it or know it. Life rarely goes according to the script, does it? But it seems like for those who know the Lord, every time you get to a point to where you, well, kind of like the children of Israel at the Red Sea, what are we going to do? God always comes through in a way that you never would have thought of, in a way that you never would have planned. And I would imagine that there are a lot of things that could be said today just about her life and the provision of God and the plan of God and the comfort of God and the peace of God, all of those kind of things that we could probably be here for a long, long time, because that's just the way it is when you know the Lord Jesus. And I was thinking about what to share, and the Lord kept bringing probably the most used scripture at a funeral service, bar none. Seems like in every funeral folder or somebody quotes something, it's Psalm 23. And I think the reason it's on my heart is because it is so relevant, not only to Ms. Rogers' life, but to our life. And as I thought about these things, the first thing that came to my mind is sometimes the most familiar things in life are the most overlooked things in life. I told my wife one time, the greatest compliment you can have as a mother is to be taken for granted. She looked at me, and I said, think about it. If your kids are amazed because you hugged them, it means you weren't hugging them enough. If they're ever amazed because you made a meal for them, it means you're not feeding them right. Those kind of things are just automatic, and they happen, and we take them for granted. And we do that every single day. I was thinking about this psalm and thought how often we take this simple psalm, this familiar psalm, so for granted. And so I'd like to take a few moments and read it and share some thoughts. You'll understand where I'm going as we do this. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me, and you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. And this one word sums it all up so wonderfully: forever. Forever. Well, I thought about just the first few words that we find in there. And I thought about, first of all, David starts off saying the Lord. You know, we take that for granted because we assume everybody believes. Not everybody believes. And if you take the Lord out of life, if you take the Lord out of anything, the whole universe falls apart. The Lord is the one who created us. The Lord is the one who created the world we live in. The Lord is the one who created the sun, the moon, and the stars. And the Bible says that he not only created it, but he also is the one who holds it all together. You think about the tremendous truth that we're not really afraid of crashing into Mars. Now, sometimes people may talk about a stray asteroid or something like that, but to be honest, we're not really afraid of that, and we don't take it all that seriously. And we don't really worry about getting too close to the sun and burning up or too far and freezing, because we have this assumption that everything's going to be okay. In fact, it's amazing how ordered the universe is by the creation of God, that you can look on your smartphone and they can tell you when the sun is going to come up next week. They can tell you what the temperature is going to be in a few days. Well, sometimes. Everything is so predictable because it's held together by the Lord. And a life that is going to be well lived and a life that's going to matter is centered around the Lord, because that's the power in our life, the Lord. But that's not really enough, not for a time like this. We could acknowledge the Lord, believe in the Lord, but there's got to be more to it. And David gives us a clue, because the next word he says is, "The Lord is." You know why I like that? He didn't say the Lord was. He didn't say the Lord was my shepherd when I stood before Goliath, but now, boy, I'm in trouble. He didn't say the Lord was the shepherd of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He didn't say the Lord is the shepherd for previous generations. He didn't say the Lord is a shepherd for old people. He said the Lord is my shepherd for now. He didn't say he will be. He didn't say one of these days God will show up. And we kind of have this view of God that he's up in heaven and out yonder somewhere, but one of these days he's going to come and fix it. Well, I do believe in the second coming of Christ, but I do not believe that that is the only hope we have, because the Lord is with us now, because he is our shepherd. That's the present tense that I think about. When you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death, when you're having financial difficulty, when your health is failing, when your kids are not acting right, when life seems to be out of control, when you don't understand politics, when you don't understand the economy, when you don't understand your neighbors, when things go like that, the Lord is your shepherd, and he's right there with you in the hard times. Yes, he's there in the good times, but also in the bad times, in the hard times, seeing you through, because the Lord is. He's a present tense shepherd. Then the third thing that I saw that David said is, the Lord is, and this is where, as I say, the rubber meets the road, my shepherd. If David just stopped and said the Lord is a shepherd, or he is the shepherd, or he is your shepherd, or someone else's shepherd, that wouldn't give any hope for you. But David came to the point where he said, he's my shepherd. Not just grandma's shepherd, not just grandpa's shepherd, not just the shepherd of somebody who lived 1,000 years ago. He is my shepherd. He had a personal walk with the shepherd. When I think about making all of this personal, I think about the time when I was in my early 20s and I was doubting a lot of things and questioning a lot of things. And the Lord made something very, very clear to me. I was born as a sinner separated from God. And everything that I did, even when I tried to be good and to do good and all of that, it always was kind of stained. It was always kind of tainted with something. And you know what I found out that something was? It was my sin. And I found out that my sin had separated me from my Creator. And if something didn't happen and something wasn't done, I wouldn't enjoy being in the house of the Lord forever. And I found out that this God who created everything, this God who is this present tense God, real and working and executing his plan and working in people's lives now. I found out that there was only one way where he could become my shepherd. I found out that this God sent his son to live on earth as a God-man, 100% God and 100% man. And this God-man, the Lord Jesus Christ, lived the life that I could never live because he never sinned. You think about that. He never thought anything that he shouldn't think. He never did anything that he shouldn't do. And here's a big one. He never failed to do anything that he should do. A perfect life acceptable to God. When Jesus is being baptized, remember that voice out of heaven said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And that's because Jesus was sent to be the Savior, the sacrifice. And they took him and they put him on a cross. And something amazing happened on that cross. It wasn't the nails. That's bad enough. It wasn't the beating that he had received. It wasn't the humiliation. Those are horrible. Do you know what the worst thing was? At one point, the Bible says he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And that kind of got my attention. If Jesus is doing the will of God, why would he ever feel forsaken by his Father? And I found out why. Because at that moment, God took Greg Keenan's sins and put them on Jesus Christ. And Jesus bore the wrath of God that I deserved. And the Bible says that God has eyes that are purer than to look upon iniquity. And at that moment when he took my sin and the sins of all who would believe, God the Father and God the Holy Spirit turned their back on God the Son. And that went on for 3 hours, and somehow the infinite Son of God took our sins, paid the penalty for them, bore the wrath of God, and then he said an amazing thing, "It is finished." I found out that that meant that the sin debt had been paid. My fine had been paid. My sentence had been paid. And 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead and 40 days later ascended to the right hand of God the Father, where he watches over me, where he prays for me, where he defends me, and where he also says, according to John 14, is preparing a place for all of those who have trusted him. And after I learned that, I realized God was not interested in me doing my best for him because that would never be good enough. God wanted me to take everything that I had and lay it at his feet and say, "Lord, I'm trusting in Jesus and Jesus alone as the full payment for my sin." And the Bible says that if you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And that's what I did. And it was at that moment that this Lord who created everything, the one who is this present tense God, that's when he became mine and I became his. And then David talks about the shepherd. What does that tell us about? Peace. Sheep are not made to be stressed out. They can't really defend themselves. They're not very smart. They don't think well. They're not defensive. They don't go on the attack. They don't do any of those kind of things, but they do panic and they are fearful, except when they have a shepherd, and the shepherd gives them peace. You knew it had to start with a P, didn't you? And so this God who is our power, who is a present tense God, who is a personal God with us, he gives us peace because he's our shepherd. A shepherd would lead the sheep. A shepherd would, so they would never be lost. A shepherd would feed the sheep to make sure they always had pasture, they always had water. And he would also protect them. In fact, when he would put them into the sheepfold, the door that was like a gate that was open, the shepherd would lay down. That's where he would sleep. so nothing could come in and the sheep couldn't get out. That's what the shepherd does. And so the sheep, what did they worry about? Nothing. And I found out that when I trusted the Lord, that if I would continually trust him and walk with him, I found out that I didn't have anything that I had to ever worry about because I got a shepherd. And it's not just a shepherd or the shepherd, he's my shepherd. And then I found out it was permanent, because as David describes all of the things that the shepherd would lead him through, he talks about being in the presence of enemies. That's scary. He talks about the valley of the shadow of death. I don't like that. You don't like that. And yet we all face that. We're going to die. People that we love are going to die. And yet the shepherd walks with us through those valleys. It's a personal relationship with him. He says that goodness and mercy follow us all the days of our lives. I knew a lady when I was a kid that her mother started losing her faculties. And she was telling her daughter, she said, there are two people that are following me. Everywhere I go, I see these two people. And her daughter looked and there was nobody there. And then she thought of Psalm 23. And she said, Mom, the Bible says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. That's what you're seeing, is goodness and mercy. And her mom went, oh, okay. And she was fine after that. That's what the shepherd does until the time comes to where we go to be with the Lord. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord, not for a month, not for a week, not for a day, not for a year, not for a decade, but that wonderful word forever. Wouldn't it be great when the time comes for you to die? When the time comes when the angels are gathered up around you and they say your name and say it's time to go home, that as you exhale that last breath, maybe the word you say is forever. Going home to be with the Lord. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord, my shepherd, forever. I hope you have that hope. Those of you watching by live stream, thank you for watching and being a part of this. I hope you have that hope. And if you don't, find someone that you know who does and ask them, how can I be born again? How can I know the Lord as my shepherd? And remember, it's all through the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, but he washed it white as snow. Can anyone say amen to that? Can we pray together? Lord, as we take the time to think about what David said in this psalm. It's a gospel psalm. It's a good news psalm because it tells us that you, the Creator, are here with us and you can actually be our shepherd and give us your peace that passes understanding and that our future is secure because whenever we leave these earthly bodies, we're going to the house of the Lord. And that'll never change. We'll be there forever. Thank you for Ms. Rogers' testimony. Thank you for her faith. Thank you for her family and their testimony of faith. And thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, who takes bitter times like this and makes them sweet. To the glory and the honor of Jesus Christ, we dedicate this service. And it's in his name we pray. Amen and amen.
As the family leaves this morning, I'm going to ask that the rest of us stand together. If you know this song, will you join me as we sing together?
The splendor of
The family, some of the family is going to come in the back of the auditorium. If you'd like to go greet them, we would ask if you have a mask, if you wear it out of respect for the whole family. But some of them are going to go back into the back of the auditorium, and you can go greet them at this time. You are dismissed.